towards the marquee on the left, where she'll receive her graduation gown. And she meets one or two classmates on the way and gives them a cheery greeting. After showing the attendant her registration documents, Yinka is presented with her graduation gown, complete with the ceremonial mortarboard cap and cape. Next, she moves on to the dressing area where the students are helped on with their ceremonial attire. Now, Yinka steps forward with a gentle smile playing about her face. The private ceremony over, the professors and faculty heads dressed in red robes lead the students in procession back to the main university campus for the traditional reception necessary in all good graduations. After the ceremony, now with her official certificate, Yinka poses for a few photographs to capture the memory of her once-in-a-lifetime achievement, along with some of the Emmanuel TV team and partners who have been with her along the journey.
Hello viewers, I just want to say thank you for the support. To Emmanuel TV partners, thank you for everything you've done. And also to Prophet Tibi Joshua, I want to say thank you so much for all the support, the inspiration and the advice. It really paid. And as you can see, now I'm wearing my graduation gown. And today is actually a very successful location. So this graduation is for all the Emmanuel TV students who have graduated, not just for me. So I want to say thank you for everything. Thank you, Emmanuel TV. This wouldn't have been possible without you. And most importantly, thank you, Prophet Tibi Joshua. Thank you.
I'm Izzat Darwaze. I'm professor of communications engineering at UCL. So that's part of the Department of Electronic and Electrical Engineering, and that is part of the Faculty of Engineering Sciences. We run several master's programs and several undergraduate programs, and Yinka was one of our master's students on a program to deal with telecommunications, which is an area that UCL has been well known for at least 100 years. Major work on communications electronics took place at UCL. In fact, electronics was created at UCL with the work of Sir Ambrose Fleming, who invented the thermionic valve, and a lot of the work to do with wireless transmission and so on happened at UCL. And for that, we end up having such wonderful MSc students and who graduate and then hopefully keep the good name of UCL flying everywhere.
I'm John Mitchell, from the Department of Electronic and Electrical Engineering. I had the pleasure of being the postgraduate tutor looking after all the MSc programs over the past year and welcoming the many fantastic students from around the world, such as Yinka, to take our courses. We're delighted to have fantastic students who take our programs and will go out and be ambassadors for UCL. To come to UCL is something of a privilege. We only select the very highest of students. So to come and study at UCL, people have done very well in their first degrees and have shown great aptitude for the technical subject. And we hope we really add value to that over the time they're here, and hope they'll go on and do wonderful things and carry our name forward as they go into their careers.
Hello, my name is Omotayo Awubuli. I finished from a master's degree in telecommunications. I was in the same class with Yinka. I can say of Yinka that she's a hard-working student, and I'm not surprised. She finished best in her class, which is a master's degree in telecommunications broadband components. And even as she goes on to go for a PhD, I believe she's going to do very well. Thank you.
Anna, I'm from Kazakhstan. I'm here for my graduation ceremony. I graduated last year in MSc Telecommunications at UCL.
I met Yinka in the library, in science library. She was working very hard, helping me a lot, especially with IPN. I think she's a very hardworking girl. She has a lot of challenges in front of her, attitude, and I think she will do all her best in her work and for the life. Yeah.
I can't stop saying everybody that they have to go to UCL, because
I think the UCL is the best university in London, one of the best universities, especially for with the medical faculty and the engineering faculty. I already work in my country, in Kazakhstan, a telecommunication company, Beeline, as a key account manager.
Hi, I'm Aaron. I joined UCL and doing my MSc. I was doing my MSc in telecoms. I started in September 2010. Currently, I'm working at BT. UCL, the journey has been amazing so far. It was, you know, I mean, coming back after a year, after graduating like in September last year, and coming back now and meeting all my friends now, it feels so surreal that a year has passed and people have moved on, everything's just changed. But UCL, you come back, the memories just come back again, and it just seems that it was just yesterday when we were like sitting in 66 Gower Street. Professor Izzat or, you know, Andy Welder or something, and just going through those courses, or sitting in the library. That's when we first met. It was in the library. Yes, and then in the library, and even before I met her in class, it was in the library. And yeah, and that's how it was. It was really great. It was amazing. Yeah, she's quite smart. She asked amazing doubts, you know. There were so many times I'd be like, I would have been like, oh, I know this. I've got this concept. And she'd ask me this one question and be like, didn't think of that. she just make me go through everything and be like, oh, that's true. Yeah, I didn't consider that. And she's asked really, really, really good questions. Even in class, you know, she was like so attentive. There were times when I'd be like, oh, this class is going on and going on. And then I'd hear a voice in the back, or she'd probably be in the front. I don't remember that, but a question would come from, and we'd be like, oh, okay, someone's paying attention. but she was really good at that, and she kept us awake that way. But to be honest, UCL MSc degree has been great. The professors have been amazing. The kind of support that they've given us is immense. The kind of industry exposure, that's what sets it apart. Because I'm not sure about other universities or my friends from other modules or departments, but this department for sure, telecoms, it's been great. We've had people from the industry coming in, talking to us, and telling us what you should be doing, or giving us excerpts from past experiences, or even getting current people from the industry coming in and giving us guest lectures and stuff. So I'm Aaron Krishnamurthy. I was studying MSc in telecoms, currently working at BT. I'm originally Indian, but I was born and raised in Kuwait, and that's that. Yeah.
My name is Asish Arya, and I'm graduating, doing computer science. UCL has been—it's been really great. The last 3 years, I've just seen myself change drastically, and it's a really good place to be. Nice people to meet, and it's just a really good step forward in your life and your career. Very good, because big companies, they usually look for graduates from the best universities, and coming to UCL is almost like a really, really good shot at having a good career later in your life. I have a job lined up for me, so I'll be working in a bank, so yeah.
Hi, my name is Asil and I'm from Kazakhstan. It was a great pleasure to study here in UCL for 1 year. It was a great experience among such kind of beautiful people, like beautiful not only by nature but also by soul. Like, I've learned many, many things in this year. And you know, when I came to London after 1 year, I had a feeling that I came to home and I missed it so much. I'm studying telecommunications with business, so I started 1 year ago. So I wish you all the best in your first study, Simka. It was a pleasure to study with you.
With the demands of the ceremony out of the way, Yinka heads to a nearby restaurant to relax, thank God, and celebrate the tremendous occasion, joined by some well-wishers on behalf of Prophet TB Joshua, the Emmanuel TV team, and partners, without whose support all this would not have been possible.
I just want to thank the man of God, Prophet TB Joshua, who has been my mentor for his support and the advice he gave me. And also, besides the financial support, his moral guidance, which has helped me to and has seen me through this period. It was quite challenging, but with God's good grace, I was able to come out with a very, very good result. So I just want to say thank you to him. And also, I would also like to thank Emmanuel TV partners who also sponsored me to go for my master's in one of the best schools in the United Kingdom. Without them, this wouldn't have been possible. I also want to thank Baba and Mama, the Babas and Mamas at the table, for their support throughout my master's period. Without this small family, it wouldn't have been possible also. It made a big difference knowing you're studying in a place where you have people you can actually talk to and share your difficult and easy moments with. So I want to thank everyone for their support and also coming to eat out after my graduation. May God bless you all. Better is not good enough. The best is yet to come.
Emmanuel, my name is Nick. I'm one of the Babas who has just been mentioned. It's a great day today to be here, and we're very pleased to join with Yinka in a happy occasion when she's achieved so much. We thank God that she has applied herself and honored the trust that has been placed in her by Prophet TB Joshua, her mentor, and achieved a super result to the glory of God. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
My name's Gary, another of the Babas, one of the Emmanuel TV team, and it's a great privilege to be here to celebrate Yinka's graduation with her. Many people would be proud, and justly proud, just to get a place at a college or university in this country. Yinka has sat with the best, and she's come out with a wonderful result, the best of the best. We just thank God for his grace upon her life. What a privilege to share this time with her.
My name is Fiona, and wow, what a wonderful honour to be here with Yinka, celebrating her incredible results. We've seen her grow and mature over the time we've known her. We've seen her enjoy and learn so much about English culture. And we thank God that the future is awesome in Jesus' name. What a privilege.
My name is Janet. I'm one of the friends of the ministry, and I'm here together with the other mamas and babas on behalf of the friends of the ministry and another Emmanuel TV partners to thank God and to thank Prophet TB Joshua for all the investment he's made in the life of Yinka. The opportunity that she's had is a rare opportunity, and it takes somebody with the grace of God upon their life to invest in the life of someone not actually knowing what they're going to achieve. But we thank God that Yinka has taken this very responsibly and very seriously. And she's not just done well, she's done exceptionally well. So we thank God for that grace, and we thank God that this is just the start, that her future is bright.
The best is yet to come, Yinka! Yay!
Emmanuel, my name is Olayinka Oduwole, and I'm here to thank the man of God and Emmanuel TV partners for all the support I've received. And I just want to say a big thank you, and I'm very happy for what God has been doing in the lives of those in the synagogue, especially in my life. I want to thank God for Prophet TB Joshua and Emmanuel TB partners who have given me an immeasurable support to pursue a PhD in engineering science. And this is my unconditional offer from the university. Initially, the University of Oxford gave me a conditional offer subject to my fulfilling some financial conditions of £100,000 for the duration of my course. So this was paid by Prophet TB Joshua and Emmanuel TB partner.
You listen to that? How much you call it?
£100,000.
Do you know how much is it in Naira? £100,000. Okay, converted it to Naira. You are talking of millions of Nairas. But when I heard about the admission, when she called me and she told me about admission, as you got admission, forget. If I need to sell my property, I will sell it to get the money. You got admission? I say yes. To Oxford? For PhD? No, don't worry about the money. Money is a small thing. Admission is very important.
The amount is 26 million naira. 100,000 pounds is equivalent to 26 million naira.
26 million naira. The partner put down when I heard the story. Hello, hi, what happened? I got admission, but they will not give me admission, 100,000 pounds. If it is 150 billion pounds, we give you, go. You are more than money. For just one person. Just one person, not two. Because for 3 years for PhD, because you will have a special professor this time that will guide her, because he's having a special field, science. The name Emmanuel TV changes life, changes nation, changes the world.
Prophet TB Joshua and the Emmanuel TV partners reaffirmed their promise to support Yinka even to the highest level of education. After making a few applications following the Prophet's advice, Yinka was offered a place to study for her PhD at the illustrious Oxford University in the United Kingdom. Before her course begins, here is Yinka, taking a walk along the riverside, accustoming herself to what will soon be her new surroundings. Quite a contrast to the mega cosmopolitan capital city of London, where Yinka has been used to living, the pace of life in Oxford is a touch slower. The streets, while still buzzing with tourists, are altogether less crowded, and the ancient, beautiful buildings and environment cultivate much more of a serene grandeur and studious atmosphere, a perfect location for Yinka to apply herself to study for her doctorate. She looks over the bridge at the ducks splashing in the water, and looks like she's already feeling right at home.
This is Ruth reporting for Emmanuel TV here in the streets of Oxford, United Kingdom. And this is where Yinka Oduwole has gained a place to study a postgraduate degree here at the University of Oxford, which is perhaps the best university in the whole world. She got her place here after gaining distinction in her master's degree in University College London, where she got distinction in broadband communications, her master's degree. After her excellent academic record, where she came the first in her class, she was granted a place right here in the University of Oxford to study a postgraduate degree, a PhD in engineering science. It's a three-year course where she'll be researching into cancer research, innovative research which will really make a difference in the world in which she lives. And this is all possible due to the support of Prophet TB Joshua and the Emmanuel TV partners. And right here we are now in the University of Oxford, perhaps the best academic institution in the entire world. Oxford University is the oldest university in the English-speaking world, and you can see the atmosphere is a wonderful atmosphere for learning, for studying, for increasing knowledge. So Yinka, we wish you all the best during your time here at the University of Oxford, and remember, as Prophet TB Joshua always says, we should pray as if everything depends on God and work as if everything depends on us. This is Ruth reporting for Emmanuel TV from Oxford, United Kingdom.
Emmanuel, this is Yinka. I recently graduated with a master's degree in broadband communications from the University College London. Not only did I finish with a distinction, but also I got the best results in my class. I'm excited because God marked my work and rewarded it with good success. As you all know, after we must have done everything humanly possible, we still need to leave it for God to mark. The rest is not to the swift, neither is the battle for the strongest. I would also like to use this opportunity to thank my mentor, Prophet C.B. Joshua, and Emmanuel TV partners who have contributed and dedicated themselves to my success. We need good, inspired and informed people to succeed in our respective callings. They have added to and multiplied my life in various aspects. The support and assistance I received was not just in terms of finance, but physically, spiritually, and in every area of life. With the assistance from the man of God, I decided to pursue a doctorate degree. I have just gained admission to study a doctorate degree in perhaps the most prestigious university in the world. I will be starting a doctorate degree in engineering science at the University of Oxford. This is a research degree and involves the design of an optoelectronic device used to detect cancerous cells. The University of Oxford is a renowned academic institution located in England. It is the oldest university in the English-speaking world. The university is renowned for its academic excellence and has produced so many intellectuals, ranging from Nobel laureates, poets, distinguished scientists, innovators, prime ministers, Olympians, notable political figures who have distinguished themselves in every area of life. Some of them include Tony Blair, Margaret Thatcher, David Cameron, Bill Clinton, Albert Einstein, Robert Hooke, Alfred Marshall, Adam Smith, C.S. Lewis, T.S. Eliot, Rupert Murdoch, to mention a few. With God's help, you can do better than you ordinarily can. This is a dream come true, which would not have been possible without the immeasurable support I received from Prophet C.B. Joshua and Emmanuel TV partners. This is Yinka standing outside the Bodleian Library, located in the University of Oxford, where I would be studying for a doctorate degree in engineering science. Thank you.
I'm Thomas Wood and I'm studying English. I'm second year at University of Oxford. It's a great course. A lot of freedom to sort of get really sort of choose sort of which subjects you're really interested in, and sort of you can really branch out, and there's not really much in the way of restrictions, so you can like spend the day in the library studying on a certain topic, or you can go to lectures. It's a lot of freedom, really, basically. Keep watching Emmanuel TV.
Hello, I'm Charlotte Smart and I'm studying geography at Jesus College, Oxford University. And I think Oxford is really great because it's full of really interested and kind of dynamic, exciting young people. I'm hoping to go into international development and do some kind of aid work with Africa.
What I make happen to other, God make happen to me. Tell your neighbor. What I make happen to others, God make happen to me. Tell your neighbor, tell your neighbor. Stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up. Say, what I make happen to others, God make happen to me. As I'm doing to others, if you know what has happened to me, oh my God, the more I do, the more God make it happen to me. So that encouraged me to do more. Tech viewers all over the world. I can't hear you. You that God has put in position, everything about you, about your family, about your children, you spend money for them, other children you don't mind about them. So someone will come from heaven to do for the other children that are poor.
I remember the last time I came here to give out my testimony. I came out with Shewan Honors, and it's all over the Nigerian media how they are doing also great in the football world. So it's a great opportunity to be part of this church, to be a youth in this great ministry, because we are all products of this ministry. It's a great church producing great products, not just in academic industry, but in football, in every other area of life. My advice to youths all over the world, especially youths in the synagogue, is that they should work as if everything depends on them and pray as if everything depends on God. They should work in the house of God, because I started in this ministry as a youth. I was involved in ushering, in looking after people, in doing all kind of chores for the ministry. The reward for this work is very great, and God is our rewarder. So youths shouldn't feel that they need to read all the time. They need to read and also relax and relax in the precious hands of the Holy Spirit. So they should work as if everything depends on them and pray as if everything depends on God. They should combine a quiet hard work with confidence in God, and God will mark their efforts and reward it. Thank
clap
you.
For her. Clap for her. Clap for her. Can you please stand up and remember your own? Your own that are obedient, your own that are stubborn. Disobedient one. Remember them, prayer. Ask God. These are children. God, remember me. Say, these are children. God, remember me. Prayer. These are children. God, remember me. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus Christ's name.
It's a windy day here in Oxford. I'm in my final year of doctoral degree in engineering science at the University of Oxford. Having completed a master's degree in broadband communications in University College London, Prophet T.B. Joshua, alongside partners of Emmanuel TV, decided to sponsor me for a doctoral degree here at Oxford. Oxford is one of the leading universities in the world and was established in the 12th century. It's one of the oldest universities in the English-speaking community. All is of grace, therefore all boasting is excluded. He who glories must not glory in himself, but must glory in the Lord. I thank God for the amazing grace to be a student here at the University of Oxford. As you all know, getting education at such a prestigious institution will go a long way in enriching and benefiting one's career and life. Thank you. I'm going to take you around the University of Oxford. I'm standing in front of the Sheldonian Theatre, where Oxford students are matriculated when they first become members of the community, and this is where they host the graduates when they finish their studies in Oxford. Union, which I am a part of, and at the union they invite high profile speakers and politicians and all sort of leaders to come and speak to the students of the Oxford community on controversial issues and all sort of societal issues that affect the community and the world as a whole. It's a National History Museum where visitors and tourists from all over the country come to see scientific exhibitions and displays within the university. As a student, I actually visit a museum from time to time. background, you can see some of the colleges. The collegiate system is a very important system here within the university. So students belong to a member of one of the colleges as well as their departments. And just within the background is the Balliol College, which has undergrads and graduate students. You can also see the Trinity College. So these are some of the oldest colleges in Oxford. I'm in front of my college, Kellogg College, where I've been assigned to as an engineering student doing doctorate degree in Oxford. So this is a place where I live, I eat and stay and meet with other international students, where we discuss on various issues that affect us as students as a whole. As you all know, we are each other's strengths, and we get to learn from each other, learn about our cultures and the different subjects which we're doing in Oxford. The Department of Engineering Science, where I study and do research. Of my department, which you can see, Department of Engineering Science, where I actually do my research.
This is the Department of Engineering Science in the University of Oxford, where Yinka spends hours upon hours doing the research for her PhD. Although the office is quiet and the other students are not around, Yinka has made the most of the opportunity to come in and study.
I'm sure you've been following my documentary of how I received the scholarship from Prophet Tibi Joshua and Emmanuel Tibi Partners to do a doctorate degree in engineering science. So now I'm in Oxford and I'm actually doing my doctorate degree. It's actually late in the evening. As you all know, we must work as if everything depends on us, and pray as if everything depends on God. And so I'm working as if everything depends on me, and I know God will crown my efforts with good success. Besides actually doing the actual research, which you can see me doing here, we are also required to do some form of teaching, which I've been doing this year, and I'm hoping to impart knowledge to some of the students who are also here. And thank you so much for following my documentary.
Part of her four-year doctorate degree at Oxford, Yinka gains invaluable experience teaching master's degree students in the Blavatnik School of Government on how to improve their policy making by looking at decisions from a scientific point of view.
When you're thinking about your energy sources, you want to think about environmental impact and the fact that the world is sort of looking towards greener, cleaner energy sources. So that should be something that should be sort of very important when you. I'm going into the lab where I do experiments. This is my lab where I do experiments. As PhD students in engineering science, we're required to do a combination of experiments and simulation. And this is one of my experiments where I look at the magnetic separation of magnetic particles with biological cells. And this is my lab. as you can see. To prepare some of the samples which I'm going to use for my experiments. At the Blavatnik School of Government, where I teach Masters of Public Policy students energy and climate change as part of my requirements for the doctorate degree in engineering science in Oxford. And so the idea of the course is to actually teach master students how to use scientific evidence to make good decisions and policies in their future careers. This is part of the requirements of the doctorate degree in engineering science here at Oxford.
Now in her final year of her doctorate degree in engineering science at Oxford University, Yinka is continuing to work hard and make the most of the opportunity given to her by Prophet TB Joshua and the Emmanuel TV partners.
As the morning water ministration takes place at the Synagogue Church of All Nations, every negative spirit is being exposed and cast out in Jesus' name. Demons are going out because they have been commanded to leave in Jesus' name. As this lady receives the ministration of the morning water, the evil spirit in her begins to manifest. Let us see how her deliverance took place.
Fire on your body. Speak out. Who are you?
Spirit. I'm dead already. I've taken her.
What do you mean you have taken her?
I'm taking her into a room that cage people that they want to kill. Her life, nothing. She's not living this life.
What have you done to her career, her marriage?
No marriage. She's not going to be married. She has a daughter. She gave birth to that daughter. No husband. She has been a single mother. She will never get married.
did you enter her?
In your dream.
Okay, in the dream. Right now, body has expired. You are going back to where you came from. In the mighty name of Jesus. Out! 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 Be free! Fire the body! Fire the body! Fire! Fire! Holy Ghost, fire!
I want to take her twice. She has an accident. But I paralyzed her leg in a dream, but she wake up and start praying.
Okay, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for this deliverance in Jesus' name. Sister, open your eyes and rise up. Jesus Christ has set you free through the medium of the morning water.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Emmanuel, my name is Hame Iria. I'm a family of nine. And my mother is a widow. I was a year when I lost my father. And it's very difficult for us to feed and to drink. It's only my mom that used to take care of all the responsibility in the house. And there was a day my mom went out, he came. He said, "Ha, my daughter, look at your situation. I dropped out when I was JSS 3. I could not afford my education." My mom said that, "You cannot afford your education. You are not working." Then I was still young. He said, "You have to come and go to abroad. People are making it, building different houses here and there. And so many girls have traveled out. I met a man that said that he will help us. Tomorrow we have to go to this man's house. The man will help you out of the country."
And sister, how old were you when your mom called you? You said you were from a family of nine. Your mother's a widow. You were brought up in a very poverty-stricken home. And your mom one day called and advised, said that you should go abroad if you want to make it. How old were you at this point?
I was like 19 years old. So he said that you have to go. And I said, "Okay." We now went to this man's house. This man now said that, it's next week. So, we have to do things sharp. I never knew that maybe he has discussed with my mommy. And I said, "Okay, it's next week we have to travel." And I said, "Okay, let's continue." They now took me to a herbalist home, in a bush like that. They now collected my fingernails. They now cut my hair. They now said that it's somebody that wants to sponsor me, that he will pay for the money, that if I run away with the money, when I get there, I have to pay them. Because of those things they have collected, I don't have to run away, that I have to pay them the money. And I said, "Okay, that if I run away with the money, I'm going to die." And I said, "Okay, I'm not going to run away since I can pay them." After now 1 week, we're now preparing. The man connected us with was coming to our house that 1 week. After 1 week has passed, the man now said that you have to go and meet one man. That man is the man that will take you through as the journey. They now took me to a place that I met some Nigerian people too, boys and girls. So many girls. We are like four boys in our group. So many girls. When I met them, they now say, "You, are you traveling too?" I say, "Yes." So we now make friends with ourselves. And I said, after 1 week later, we have to travel. From there, we now move on to Cotonou. From Cotonou, they did not allow us to pass through the border. And I said that it's another day. They have to settle with the immigration before they will allow us to cross through that Cotonou border. So then, no passport, nothing. They say it's night that we have to cross through that border. We now cross the border. From that border, in the night, inside that bush, inside the Cotonou place, they now book a vehicle for us to move to Burkina Faso. So for that Burkina Faso, we now go to a hotel, a very big hotel. It's only our group was there then. When we got there, they now book a room for us. We now stay like a day. They now look food for us to eat. from that Burkina Faso. It's in the ninth bus that we enter. They say that we don't have to come outside, though. They don't want all those police people to cut us, that we have to stay inside. Nobody should go out. So from there, they now say, you people should get ready. After 1 week, we have to move from here. That 1 week, we did not move. We spent like 3 weeks in hotel in that Burkina Faso. They say that there is a vehicle that will move us from that Burkina Faso. So,
and during that time, you were inside throughout. You were not allowed inside, out.
They don't allow us to go out. So for that Burkina Faso, I say, okay, 2 weeks now passed. The last day, they now say that we have to move from there to a place. They now book a vehicle for us to, they say, Mali. Now go to a Mali. When we go to that Mali, there were so many Nigerian people there. It was a very big house. Like a camp.
Okay, now we want to ask you at this point, sister, when you had been moved from Cotonou there to Burkina Faso, did you actually know what you were going to do in the country you were going to? Did you have an idea that, had they told you this is what you're going to do?
No, I was on journey then. They never have to tell me anything. A man came, he now said, no flight, so now desert, now I won't go past, so. And I say, desert, how? I say, you are just joking. How can we pass? They say it's flight that we have to take. Desert, is it the abroad that we are going to? They say, no, we have to pass through that place before we get to where we are going to. From that Mali, we spent so many months. From there, they have different group to group. They brought the jeep. They say that this is our old group side. This is our group side. They group different group together. This is a desert car. That we have to pass through this car. They loaded us as if that we are sardine. Can't even move our body, not to move our leg. I was just crying. I said, is this how I want to continue my journey?
And sister, which desert are you referring to?
They call it Sahara Desert.
The Sahara Desert.
That's yes, Sahara Desert.
So what you thought you would go by plane, travel by plane, yes. You now found yourself cramped in a vehicle, many of you cramped together in a very small space, being told you're going to travel across the Sahara Desert.
Yes, yes. In that desert, you will go to a point, they now stop. They now say that they cannot continue this journey. They have to turn back to Mali. That we have to trek from that desert. Inside that desert, you can't breathe well. That place was so hot, so horrible. I trek and trek and trek inside the desert.
You mean you had to come down from the vehicle and start walking?
Walking. They now gave us our bag, forage bag. They now gave us a canvas. So they said we have to, this time for trekking, that we have to trek. And I said, I cannot continue this journey trekking. Is it trekking that we have to trek so? Overseas. I said, no, me, I cannot come. They say, you have to walk. The gate man was shouting, walk or walk. If you don't walk, you will just die.
And as you were trekking in the Sahara Desert, I mean, what were the type of things you were seeing? Were there any experiences you had there that you can never forget, some things that you saw?
When we were trekking in that desert, we met all these Arab people. Those Arab people, they used to tie something on their head. So they now attack us on our way walking through the desert. They now say that we should bring our money, that if we don't give them money, they will rape all the girls. And we have so many girls. So the guide men, so those people that is leading us now say that we don't have to rape them, no. That we don't have any money that we have to give them. So they now started fighting with those Arab people. So we now dismissed, everybody scattered. And in our midst, there's a guy in our midst that lost his life during that fight. So we now continue with the journey. As we continue with the journey, so they say we are trekking to Algeria. So I now say, Algeria, where is Algeria? I mean, I don't even know Algeria. So they say we have to trek. We trek for so many days. We now go to Algeria. In that Algeria, there is another place again in Algeria. It's a very big camp again, very big place. And there's many Nigerian, different country inside that camp. We now go there, they now welcome us. They now say, welcome to this place. So at this place, how do you find your journey in that desert. You cannot explain that because they passed through the desert too. We spent months in that Algeria. They said that we have to move on from that Algeria again. We now trek again. We trek night and morning through that train track. When the day wants to get light, we'll go and hide. In the night, we'll continue again. I was so tired. That place, my hands, it was winter time, my hands was freeze. My leg was heavy. And I said that we will soon get to where we are going to. Every time they will say we will soon get there. They will tell us that, go and look at that light that is shining, that we will soon get to that light. I will say, we will trek, we will not see the light. I was trekking with them. We now get to a city that is called Uzla. They call it Uzla. It's a village in Morocco. So
you'd gone from Algeria to Morocco.
Yes.
And tell us, at this point where you had reached Morocco, how long had you been on this journey?
I spent years in that journey before I get to Morocco.
I hope we're hearing this, brethren. She said she spent over a year on this journey just to get to Morocco.
So from there, and I say, okay, this is Uzra. And that place again, that place, that Morocco village, that place is a village. It's another big camp again. And I met some Nigerian people, some different country again. They're inside that camp. Nigerian people is very many inside the camp. And that place is so horrible, so difficult than the place I have never seen in my life in that for all my journey.
A similar camp to what you was in Algeria, where all of these people trekking through the desert were staying together. You went to another camp in Morocco. Now just describe the conditions, the living conditions in that camp.
In that Uzra, if you want to sleep, you cannot turn. You cannot, it's very narrow that I cannot even explain. They will just pack you like this. If you are sleeping, you have to wake person that is very close to you. Please don't let me face you. Then all those Arab people, they got an information that Nigeria people, Africa people is living in that camp.
Okay, sorry, before you go ahead, sister, you mean that there were so many people in this camp that even to sleep, you couldn't even lie down. You would be laying next to the people beside you.
Yes, you'll be breathing, you'll be torn, you can't even turn. You have to wake somebody very close to you. Please turn, let me turn, because they will just line you people somehow. So from there, then I spent so many months in that Uzra country. From there, police people, all those Arab people, informed all those police. They now came, they now bago at enter the house. They now say that everybody now ran away. That I was sick. I was so sick because of the journey. I cannot even walk. I cannot even run. So understand, I was just managing myself to escape with them because of all those policemen. They were scattering everything. So I have to manage that. And I say that.
Okay, now, because of the conditions in this camp and the long journey, you said you had fallen sick. I mean, what type of sickness did you have?
I was sick that I cannot walk very well because of that trek that I trekked throughout the desert. That I not got to a place that where they were running away from police. I cannot even walk well. So they now got me to a point that they now lay me inside valley. They say that I cannot continue the trekking with them. My sickness was so serious that I cannot walk. I cannot move my neck. I cannot move my hand. So they now left me. Then I was not crying. I said that, you don't want to go leave me like this. You people cannot leave me like this. So I want to die. So this is how we end up my life in this place. Then I said that you have to stay.
Okay, so our sister has reached a point in her journey where she is running away from police that had raided the camp that she was in Morocco, along with thousands of other people who were taking an illegal journey through Africa. And she was so sick, her body was stiff, she was unable to continue the journey, that the people that were with her running away had to leave her. So, sister, do you mean to say that you were left alone in the middle of a valley, of the wilderness in Morocco?
Yes.
So, what was your condition at that point?
I was just thinking that I'm not going to survive, that I'm going to die. They just let me there. They not let me inside the valley there. I thought that maybe I'm going to die because I cannot walk. I cannot move my hand and my leg. I was just laid down on the valley there. They not cover me with the blankets. They not left me. So when I was there, before the day gets dark, a shepherd now came. They now came. He now said that he was speaking Arab. Me, I don't even hear the Arab they were speaking. He now touched my heart. My heart was, I was blinking my heart. He was just shaking my body. Never known that he wants to go and call all those ambulance people to come and pick me. He now came with those ambulance. They now took me to hospital.
So a shepherd in the middle of nowhere located you as you were about to die in this wilderness in Morocco.
Yes.
And he didn't speak the same language as you?
No, he's speaking Arab.
So he just came and called an ambulance and they came and picked you up at that spot in Morocco.
Yes, yes. So from that place, they now took me to the hospital. They now loaded me into a ambulance and took me down to the hospital. So then I was saying, thank God that I will still survive, that they already take me to the hospital. So in that hospital, I met a lady in the hospital there, and there was no any Nigerian people there. I was the only Nigerian girl that was inside that hospital. And then, no food to eat, nothing. But they now gave me a bread and a milk to drink. So then I was sharing the woman that was laying with me, any food they bring for her, she will share it with me. If they bring ample for her, she will share her ample with me. She was just sharing her food with me. Then they were just started doing their treatment on me. But then I will not say that, thank God they are doing all those treatments that I will still survive. I was just getting better. After some weeks, I was getting better. Even then, if I want to toilet, I will toilet there, they will go and throw it away from me. So when those Arabs see me that I was recovering, they now say that, this guy is getting better. I was just trying, I will try to sit down, I will try to move and say, thank God I'm getting better. So then I can go to toilet myself. I can move from those places. I was just learning how to walk in that hospital. They now say that. From that place.
Okay, just before you go ahead, sister, if not for the shepherd that discovered you lying lifeless on the ground, we know definitely you would have lost your life in this condition in Morocco. For all the people you traveled with, both from Nigeria and people you met, do you mean to say that many of them did not make it?
Many of them did not make it at all. Many of them died. And then, I did not even see those one we came with. I didn't even hear from them. Even till now, I did not hear from anyone. I don't know anyone again. So then, when I was laying out to work, they not came. Police people not came.
Okay, at this point, you had been in hospital for how many months?
I was like 2 months. So they not came. Those police people not came. And I said, this one, where all these police people come to this hospital? Are they going to help me? Thank God, though. Maybe they want to take me back to Nigeria. I was so happy that they came. Never knowing that they want to take me to a cell, they now handcuffed me again, took me back to prison. So in that prison, I now met some few group, not so many, like 7 of the Nigerian people inside that prison. And I said, thank God that I meet my people here, they are here again. And I said, auntie, where are you coming from? They say, please don't talk to me. Your problem is different from my own. And those people, they are from Tanger, from Hot Town in Morocco. They deported them from Tanger to that place, into that prison. So I said, auntie, I was pleading with them so that they would be of help to me. Please, auntie, let me follow you. He said, no, you cannot follow me. There's another guy there, let me follow you. They said, no. So I now met another guy again. And I said, uncle, please, I want to follow you. You can help me. I want to go back to my country. He said that you cannot go back to your country unless maybe flight come, you can go back, but you cannot go back. There's no flight for you, no passport for you to go back. I was just crying. On that process, inside that prison, that is where I met my baby father, inside the prison. So from that prison, then I thought that maybe they want to move off from when they now take us again, took us to Algeria between Morocco and Algeria boundary. They